good morning, Troy View.
Morning.
Hi.
Morning.
Guys, excited to be here?
Woo!
I'm excited to be here. It's a kickoff tonight. We have the Junior Youth President's Day lock-in.
Oh yeah.
So I'm excited to be up all night with those guys. It's a great time. If you want to come out and hang out with us for a little bit tonight, you are more than welcome to play some silly games with us. We use M&Ms, lifesavers, cotton balls, balloons.
Cheesy puffs?
No, we're not doing that one ever again. All kinds of fun stuff. So just Brian Green can't come and play Happy a Hungry Hungry Hippo with us. So he knows why. He's colorblind. Anyway, so he can't find the right pit balls to bring back. All right, so we got Junior Youth President's Day lock-in tonight, April 5th through the 7th is the high school college age lock-in, Carpe Diem, at our new campground, and we're staying in the Warner Building. And so that's for the high school age up through college age. We'll be having a nice weekend there. But before that, we have Easter candy making. Cheryl has the forms. So if you are a youth person or some people who like to eat a lot of peanut butter eggs, I think we might have to have a contest with you guys.
We don't stand a chance.
So you can eat the most peanut butter eggs. Check with Cheryl. Actually, all of the proceeds from this go straight to the youth because all the most of the ingredients are donated, which is a fantastic thing. So we have that
donation,
and she has a donation sheet as well. So like peanut butter, powdered sugar, M&Ms, Rice Krispies, butter,
marshmallows,
a 15-passenger van, kind of things like that. Those can be donated. All right. Okay. So we have that coming up in that. And I'm lost with my dates. I know it's in March. So the Friday before Palm Sunday.
March 22nd.
We'll start at 9 a.m. This is for making of the eggs. And this is for adult hands only. Okay, so if you are interested in helping us shape the eggs, I'll let you eat some if you're able to come. But if not, you have to wait. So we'll need adults to help shape those eggs. And then on that Saturday, I need all the youth to be here. To help do the Rice Krispie nest and the suckers and all that other kind of good stuff, okay? And then they're going to be given out on Palm Sunday. And then, coming up in June, of course, we have Strawberry Festival. We have Youth, which is Seize the Day, S-E-A-S, which we're going to be talking about sea stories in the Bible. And after, a week after that, we'll have a break, then we'll have our mission trip charge, and that is for 8th grade and up. And we're going to do our mission work here in our local churches. So hopefully everybody can take part in that. All right, that's all the youth stuff going on. Next Sunday we have a luncheon.
Delicious luncheon. Me and James are going to cook lunch for you guys. Just bring yourselves. If you would want to make a donation to the Deacon Fund, that's okay. But if you don't feel obligated. Me and James would like to just do this for you guys to feed you a little bit.
There you go. All right, so we got that next Sunday. We can have food. Great. All right. Anything else coming up?
My birthday.
Your birthday? Okay. All right. We'll celebrate that. Okay. Do we have any prayer requests at this time? Prayer praises. Kent?
My dad did have they said it was the closest thing to a stroke, but not having a stroke, but he's okay now. So that's a praise.
For those of you, I asked Dan last week. One of my employees, Tony, he's 2 months now, but he had an infection. They could not figure out what the infection was. He had a spike 104 temperature. They had him down at Children's. They ran all kinds of tests, could not find why he was having this infection and what was going on. They eventually found out that he has an issue with his urinary tract infection. And so that caused an infection, or his urinary tract, which caused a type of E. coli infection. And so he's going to have this, this could happen to him up until he's 6 months old, so he can have surgery to repair it. And then after that's done, so. But the power of prayer, because Tony was out most of last week, and I sent Dan a message, I think it was, Friday morning, about praying. And when Tony came back on Tuesday this past week, and I was talking to him about it, he said he went Thursday. He was very lethargic, very white. They were just very scared. And then Friday, He perked up. He was his normal self. The power of prayer. Can you not believe that? And I don't know how many times over the last year that things have happened and I put the message out. Guys, we got to pray for you again. I did the one time with Brendan. We got to pray for this. And boom. There's God. He has always been there. But sometimes we forget to get to him first. And we try to look at other things. And we forget to get God first. Because he's always there. So let's go to God in prayer. Father God, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the many people that are here today. God, I just ask that you speak your word of truth through our lives. God, that word will excite us. That word will help us exemplify your love that you have for us, that we can share with other people so that this message is not in vain. That we have that hope of the future with Jesus Christ in your kingdom. In all these things we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Tried it, but my microphone wasn't going to work today, so that somebody else had to come up here and do this. Anybody want to? Nope. All right. We're going to start off by singing a few more upbeat songs, Reckless Love, Rest on Us, and we're going to do probably two more after that. So if you'll stand with us, we're going to start off by singing Reckless Love.
Over the water.
gates of the heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates of the heaven on in.
Come rest on us. Come rest on us.
Calm down. Swear when you move, you make my heart.
Go, 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 go.
You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Amen. You can be seated. It's time. Children are dismissed from your church.
The Jewish leaders and high priest petitioned Festus to have Paul tried in Jerusalem. Initially, he refused, but they traveled here to Caesarea and petitioned again. And wanting to win favor with them, he asked Paul if he would be willing to go. Paul knew that the plan was to kill him on the way, and so now he exercised his right as a Roman citizen to stand before Caesar. Festus answered, "Unto Caesar you have appealed, and unto Caesar you will go." While Paul was waiting here for the ship to take him to Rome, King Agrippa and his wife Bernice came by to see Festus, and hearing about Paul's situation, they asked to see him. Right here in this room, Paul was able to give a defense of his faith and his powerful testimony, and it's recorded in Acts chapter 26. When he was finished, King Agrippa, maybe unaware of his surroundings for a few moments, said, "Almost you persuade me to be a Christian." These two men, Felix, who asked for a convenient time, and Agrippa, who was almost persuaded, represent a large class of people today. Those who are convicted but are stubborn, and those who want a better time where there's no obstacles to give their life to Jesus. If you are thinking of giving your life to Jesus today, don't delay. The best time to give your life to Jesus is always the earliest time. May we not be almost persuaded like Agrippa, but fully persuaded of who Jesus is and what he has done for us today.
That's more if you've been following us through the book of Acts on Festus and Agrippa in the scriptures. The book of Acts, he's talking about persuading people to know Jesus. How did Paul persuade people? Do we need to persuade people to know and follow Jesus? Or is that offensive? Does that trigger people that they might be wrong and Jesus is right and the only right way? The only way to truth and life. Paul didn't care. He persuaded people anyway. But some people say, so we should just love people. We should just help practical needs. And yeah, we want to do that. But it doesn't stop with practical needs. We want to meet, as much as we can, people's physical needs in this world. Difficulties that they're going through. We help them, give them a hand up. But that's not all there is in this world. We know that. There's eternity to come. And so what did Jesus do? He fed people and then he told them about the kingdom. He healed people and then he told them about the kingdom. Helping and helping eternally. That's what we want to be doing. That we see Paul doing too. Sharing the truth about the gospel. The truth about the Jesus. About the Messiah. If you want to turn with me in your Bibles, your scriptures, Bible apps, Acts chapter 25. We have got to be ready and willing to share God's truth with people. To share about who God is, what he's done, and what he's promised that he's going to do. And Paul loved this. And we, I don't know, maybe American Christianity strayed too far from this. And we say, yeah, I have a Bible somewhere, and sure, I believe in Jesus, but I'm not going to try to persuade you. I'm not going to try to convince you that you're wrong, because that's kind of mean. No, we have got to be willing to step up to the plate, and maybe the ball's going to get thrown at us and hit us. Ow! Maybe like Paul, we're going to get hurt. Bad things are going to happen. Trouble's going to come. It does in other countries when you share the name of Jesus. And it has in America before and more to come. But we've got to be sharing the unstoppable truth that God has in His Scriptures, revealed through His Scriptures. Because truth does matter. I know we live in a world that's... we're going to get into this a little bit today, but just... my truth is my truth, and your truth is your truth. But I'm telling you, that's not how truth works. Okay? So we've got to share God's unstoppable truth. One way, one Messiah, one kingdom to come, one life. His name is Jesus. And the world will try to convince you otherwise, that they're... you make up your own truth, but that's, again, not how truth works. So if you're there in Acts chapter 25, say amen. Amen. All right, good. Acts chapter 25, picking up where we left off last week with verse 1. And here we go. Now 3 days after Festus had arrived in the province, he went up to Jerusalem from Caesarea. And the chief priests and the principal men of the Jews laid out their case against Paul. Here we go again. And they urged him, asking as a favor against Paul that he summon him to Jerusalem, because they were planning an ambush to kill him again on the way. Verse 4, Festus replied that Paul was being kept at Caesarea and that he himself intended to go there shortly. So he said, let the men of authority... among you, go down with me, and if there is anything wrong about the man, let them bring charges against him. After he stayed there among them not more than 8 or 10 days, he went down to Caesarea, and the next day he took his seat on the tribunal and ordered Paul to be brought. Here he comes. Verse 7, when he had arrived, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him, bringing many and serious charges against him that they could not prove. Once again, Paul argued in his defense, neither against the law of the Jews, nor against the temple, nor against Caesar have I committed any offense. You guys are making stuff up. Verse 9, but Festus, wishing to do the Jews a favor, political move, said to Paul, do you wish to go up to Jerusalem and there be tried on these charges before me? But Paul said, I am standing before Caesar's tribunal, where I ought to be tried. To the Jews I have done no wrong, as you yourself know very well. He was familiar with Jewish things. Verse 11, if then I am a wrongdoer and have committed anything for which I deserve to die, I do not seek to escape death. But if there is nothing to their charges against me, no one can give me up to them. I appeal to Caesar. That's a thing a Roman citizen could do, go to a higher court. Verse 12, then Festus, when he had conferred with his council, answered, to Caesar you have appealed. To Caesar you shall go. Verse 13. Now, when some days had passed, Agrippa the king and Bernice arrived at Caesarea, greeted Festus. And as they stayed there many days, Festus laid Paul's case before the king, saying, there is a man left prisoner by Felix. And when I was at Jerusalem, the chief priests and the elders of the Jews laid out their case against him, asking for a sentence of condemnation against him. Keep trying to go against Paul. Verse 16. I answered them that it was not the custom of the Romans to give up anyone before the accused met the accusers face to face and had opportunity to make his defense concerning the charge laid against him. So when they came together, I made no delay, but on the next day took my seat on the tribunal and ordered the man to be brought. When the accusers stood up, they brought no charge in his case of such evil as I supposed. Rather, they had certain points of dispute with him about their own religion and about a certain Jesus who is dead, but who Paul asserted to be alive. Verse 20. Being at a loss how to investigate these questions, I asked whether he wanted to go to Jerusalem to be tried there regarding them. But when Paul had appeared to be kept in custody for a decision of the emperor, I ordered him to be held until I could send him to Caesar. Then Agrippa said to Festus, I would like to hear the man myself. Tomorrow, said he, you will hear him. Finishing this chapter, verse 23. So on the next day, Agrippa and Bernice came with great pomp. Check this out. And they entered the audience hall with the military tribunes and the prominent men of the city. Then at the command of Festus, Paul was brought in. He's got quite the audience. And Festus said, King Agrippa and all who are present with us, you see this man about whom the whole Jewish people petitioned me, both in Jerusalem and here, shouting that he ought not to live any longer. But I found that he has done nothing deserving of death. And as he himself appealed to the emperor, I decided to go ahead and send him. But I have nothing definite to write to my lord about him. Therefore, I have brought him before all of you, and especially for you, before you, King Agrippa, so that after we have examined him, I may have something to write. For it seems to me unreasonable in sending a prisoner not to indicate the charges against him. So that's 25. Chapter 25, we're going through the book of Acts, verse by verse, seeing all that God is doing after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. This is a story, the true story of what happened with the early church. And now Paul, we see he's embroiled in another court sort of trial thing. And we'll see next week. Come back next week. This is going to be real powerful. It's powerful every week because it's the scriptures and it's Jesus. But Paul shares his testimony. He is before. You see the end of this chapter, 25. He gets a huge audience. What's he going to say? I'll tell you, just a little sneak preview. Look at chapter 26, verse 25. Just one little verse. This is a teaser trailer for next week, all right? He says, "But Paul said, I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I am speaking true and rational words." So Paul's not just making stuff up. Paul's not just doing emotionalism. Paul's not just, saying whatever's popular in that day that people believe. He says, I have the truth. I have this unstoppable truth of what God has done in our world through Jesus, what he's done for me personally, and what he's going to do, what he's promised to do in the future. And Paul and Peter and all these people in Acts are like, we cannot stop telling the truth. And in our world today, what do? Kind of the opposite. Well, I don't want to tell the truth. I don't want to offend you. I don't want to make you feel uncomfortable or awkward or unfriend me on Facebook. Well, we got to tell the truth. You can write this down. If you're taking notes, the fill in the blank. We got to have courage to speak the truth in a world filled with lies. This is really, really... I hope you realize this. Our world's filled with lies. If you don't, read this and compare it with the world today. And your eyes might be opened. So many lies in our world today. And Paul here is combating truth with lies, just like we are in our world, hopefully. Paul's enduring serious accusations once again. These people are accusing him, and he's defended himself, not with, I feel this way, not with, this is my truth, but he says, these are the facts. I didn't do it. I didn't cause a riot in the temple. I didn't cause all these Gentiles to come. I didn't let them in. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. You guys are just making stuff up to try and get me killed, and they were again and again. Paul had committed no wrong, and he was combating these lies with truth. Because he didn't fear death. They could have done all kinds of stuff to him. And they did. And they did to Jesus. And they've done to so many Christians since then. Hurt him. Killed him. Tortured. Beaten. For believing the truth of the scriptures. For believing the truth of Jesus. But Paul, he has no fear. He's like, do whatever you want, but this is the truth. Could we say that? In our world. Do whatever you want to me. And this happens in certain countries, in many countries around the world. You can hurt me, you can beat me, you can murder me, but I believe the truth of Jesus. Are you convicted that much to say that? Are we? America, it's kind of loosey-goosey. We got our freedom, and we may never be asked in our lifetime, do you believe in Jesus like Cassie and Columbine? Or if you do, I'm going to put a bullet in your head. We may never be asked that question. But people are around the world. And would we be fearless, courageous enough to stand up for God's unstoppable truth like Paul is here? He was committed to doing the right thing. Paul was committed to speaking the truth in a world filled with lies. Are we? That's my question. Are you and I? So, he gets to go in front of this. This is so cool. All these political leaders, all these military leaders. He's got an audience. Like, it's not the Colosseum, but it's this huge stage, auditorium, filled with people. And Paul, I think God set this up. He's been given the opportunity to share about Jesus once again. And then he even, not just before Festus and Agrippa and these kings and governors, but next week we'll see, or in the coming weeks, he gets to go to Rome, which is like the heart of civilization back then. This is huge. And Caesar, before Caesar, the leader of like the modern world back then, he gets to go in front of all these influential, culture-making, power-filled people, military officers. Wow. How did he have the strength to do this? To go through all these trials and difficulties? Because he was convicted at his core. He was convinced nothing could separate him from this truth. Neither prison or torture or shipwreck, we'll see in a few weeks, or hate and discrimination and false accusations, even death, could not separate him, could not stop him from preaching this truth about Jesus. This is powerful. His strength, his confidence and conviction. It doesn't come from him, though. It came from his confidence in the scriptures, his faith in who God said he was, and who and what God said he was doing, and what God said he was going to do. He had unstoppable faith and belief in the truth of God. That there was a much deeper thing in this world than me, myself, and I. And that Jesus is the only way, the only truth, the only life. That's it. Lots of lies in our worlds. But he knew that apart from Jesus, you wouldn't know life. You wouldn't know eternal life. And so he spent all of his days since that road to Damascus telling people about the Messiah who saved him and who can save you, so that they too would know the truth and have life eternal that starts today and goes on forever. Our world doesn't want to believe in universal truth, absolute truth, unstoppable truth, historical truth through the scriptures, but it's there. I like this thought here. The truth is still the truth, even if nobody believes it. And a lie is still a lie, even if everybody believes it. I thought that was pretty good. I read that this week. The truth, I'll say it again. The truth is the truth, even if nobody believes it. And a lie is still a lie, even if everybody believes it. I was kind of like, ooh, wow. That's good. Because you will be attacked. Our faith is attacked on a daily basis. In some way or another, around the world and in our country, people are saying, that's not truth. This is my truth, and you guys need to be tolerant and accepting and affirming and believe and all these things. But there's truth in the scriptures that just, we could go through a million different subjects, and we're not. But the lies that our culture believes, the things that they profess to be true or unique to the individual, or if I believe this about the world or myself, then it magically becomes true. And I know it's hard to... We don't like to tell people they're wrong, just like we don't like to be told that we're wrong. But there is a love, like we talked about last week, God's unstoppable love. And love tells people the truth in a grace-filled way, in a compassionate way. Yeah, Nancy, you want to tell me some hard truth?
Well,
Dan, you're a bleepity-bleepity-blankety what?
I do that.
Not on camera, no, you wouldn't.
No. I've been reading the letters of Paul to his various church communities.
And he said some truth there, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you're foolish.
I think it wasn't so hard to convert people, but it was hard to keep them on the right path, because it seemed like they would convert.
Oh.
And then he was very angry about all these other influences that would come in the communities.
They convert, but kind of bring their Greek philosophies and ways of living with them before. Yeah, that's all of us today too. Sure.
And I think, in a way, well, I'm struggling with it. And I think, as I said, I think faith isn't necessarily a static thing. I think it every day you have to commit to it, and it's hard to convey that.
Yeah.
I think, without sounding namby-pamby and
Mamby-pamby, I like that, yeah.
I'm not one of these people that can go, yes, you know, just really get out there and
sir.
Preach the word.
Hellfire and brimstone, yeah. That's Nancy, but, right.
No, not really. But,
we all struggle with our faith, with the truth, I think, but we got to be convicted. This is the truth, and it does change our life. There's a class that I really appreciated this morning by Chris Lucas. We'll do a plug for it later, but she is talking about our beliefs and how they influence our lives. What our church believes and why, and the difference that it makes. And it does. It changes the way we live, and we just got to keep chasing after this truth. It's hard some days when the world's just like, lies, 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 lies. And when our past, you know, we're bent towards this sin and these proclivities, just like the early Christians were, and they wanted to keep doing the things that they were used to doing. It's hard to break off that track of sin sometimes. That's why we need people around us for accountability and, should I say, hard love? What do they call that?
Tough love,
yeah. Tough love to say, Dan, you're being dumb. Stop it. I'm like, Rachel, you're right. Elaine, you're right. I know. See, they tell me the hard truth. We all need people in our life to tell us the truth. Boy, a leader who just everybody says, whatever you do is right. You know, Kim Jong-un or whatever your name is, or General Z, or everything you say and do is right. Well, they just, that doesn't work out very well. we become a tyrant. And we say, well, I can do whatever I want and however I want. And that leads to a lot of different things in our culture. With these lies, I want to share a verse with you. Satan is called the God of this age. And his native language is lies. And he speaks in lies. There's no truth in our spiritual enemy. He's a father of lies. And he's been lying and deceiving and tricking people for years to not believe this truth, to suppress the truth. And Paul tells Timothy, you're talking about early letters, Nancy. Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 4, for a time is coming. Tell me what this sounds like today. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. Does that sound like our world today? Paul says, they will reject truth and chase after myths. Our world today rejects so much truth and just chases after myths and lies because it feels good and it sounds good and it gets me what I sort of want in my sinful nature. There's a couple, we're not going to spend a lot of time on it, but there's a couple ideologies called relativism, which is that there's no absolute truth, and whatever you want to believe is whatever, right? No such thing as absolute truth. You make your own truth. And there's subjectivism, the idea that what you believe is not subject to a higher authority, and that you have the right to determine what's wrong and what's right for yourself and whoever. There's no authority outside yourself. It's just however you feel, right? And I think with relativism and subjectivism, and we could talk about that more another time, but it's, you're like, what in the world is, yeah, so we're just doing a gravity test, okay? And I'm going to just chuck this at Nancy. No. Do you think it's going to go up or down if I drop it? Okay. Here's the truth about the world. Greg likes this. Facts don't care about your feelings, okay? The truth doesn't care about your feelings. Facts could give a rip about your feelings. It doesn't matter how you feel. The truth is still the truth, whether you believe it or not. Even if I say, well, I don't believe in gravity. I don't believe that things, when you drop them, they go down. I think I feel like when you drop things, they should go up. They go up. In my mind, my truth, when I drop things, they go up. Do you think that, how's that going to work? Let's try it. Well, that was boring. That was kind of dumb. It went down. Unless you have a helium balloon, gravity on this earth is always going to do what gravity does. You drop something, is it going to go up? No, what goes up must come down, right? Didn't Isaac Newton say, okay. So even if I throw it up, even if I toss it up, it doesn't matter. The gravity is still pulling it to the earth. You guys know this because when we trip, we fall, right? We don't go up. I just want to show you that there is such a thing as absolute truth. You can say, I don't feel like gravity's real. I don't like gravity. A lot of people don't, right? I don't like that when I trip, I fall and I go down. But the truth doesn't care what you feel. The gravity doesn't care what you think. It just is gravity. And God's truth is kind of like that. Sometimes, a lot of times. It's just, this is true. You can believe it. You can deny it. You can make up a whole theology, ideology against it. But at the end of the day, gravity still goes down. At the end of the day, you can feel however you want to feel. You can say whatever you want to say. You can say my truth is my truth and your truth is your truth. But God's truth is the truth. It's not a truth. It's the truth. Jesus isn't a way, one way to God. He is the way, the truth, and the life. A lot of people think all religions lead to what you call God. That's what Oprah says, right? You pick whatever path you want to enlightenment and love. That's not how truth works. All these world religions, so many of them, they contradict with one another. How can this be true at the same time that this is true? It just doesn't work. God's truth. Whether you believe it, you know, it's like so many principles in the scriptures, whether you believe them or not, they're just true. You reap what you sow. Have you heard that? Whether you believe in God or not, you're going to reap what you sow. You're going to get out what you put in. Some people call that karma, I guess. It's not quite the same, but truths are truths from God, no matter how we feel. And gravity, every single time I do this silly illustration, it's still going to go down. It doesn't matter how we feel. And I know maybe we shouldn't start off conversations with, I don't care how you feel. That's not a great conversation starter. That's not a great way to approach somebody. But the truth is that there are truths that are just true, and we don't have to like them for them to be true. I'll give you a couple examples for my truth is my truth. Here's what our world says. Just some real quick lies. Do whatever you want as long as it makes you happy. Right? Have you heard that? People say that. We think that sometimes. Do whatever you want as long as it makes you happy. Except the problem, the issue with this is that it causes a lot of problems in our society and in our world. People chasing after happiness, happy feelings in this lifetime, and it causes a lot of hurt, pain, and destruction. What we think is our happiness ultimately oftentimes is not. Axe murderers are doing what makes them happy. I'm just saying. I'm just putting that out there. Like, you wouldn't tell Ted Bundy, do what makes you happy. Except we say that to so many people, and that's just a cultural thing. Do whatever makes you happy, right? Or how about this one? You can believe whatever you want as long as you're sincere, right? Just be sincere. Except things contradict with each other, and we can be sincere and be sincerely wrong. Like, I sincerely believe that gravity is wrong. I'm wrong. Look, I'm wrong. And Rachel tells me that all the time. Dan, you're wrong. Dan, no, she's not here. No, she doesn't. But sometimes. When I am. We can be sincere and be sincerely wrong. Here's the last one. Do whatever you want as long as it doesn't hurt anyone. Yeah, God told us to be happy. God said, be holy as I am holy. He didn't say, be happy. Sometimes we're going to be happy, but we have joy that goes beyond our circumstances. And then, as long as it's not hurting anyone, we can say that. People can say that. But sin has an effect in this lifetime or the next, in ourselves and in the people around us and in our society. When we go against the truths of God, we may not feel like at this moment that we're hurting anybody, but when we're sinning, we are hurting ourselves and others. And we could have a lot longer conversation about all these things, but we're not. So if you want to talk about this more, let me know. I'll meet up with you. I'd love to buy you tacos or coffee or whatever. And there's a lot that can be said about truth, and we just can't cover it all today. But I want to say a few final things. Proverbs 14. There is a way that appears to be right. This is like our world so much. Solomon says, there is a way that appears to be right. But in the end, what does it do? It leads to death. I feel this way. I feel like this is my truth. This makes me happy, and I'm not hurting anybody, and I'm sincere. And you'll hear a lot of these things, these lies in our culture. And it's so hard when you love somebody and they're believing these lies. What do you do? I don't know. Every situation is different. But God has given us a truth, the truth in His Scriptures, His Holy Word of God, and the way, the life, the truth. This is Jesus. And when we go against Him, we're believing lies, we're following lies, and we're, like Proverbs says, going towards a path that ends in destruction. So we got to seek to follow and proclaim, like Paul, the truth in a world of lies. Now, we got to do it with grace and love. Grace and love. Grace and love. I think it was 2014, we did a message series called True-ish. It's kind of like that. Feels good and makes you happy. And I want to send that out this week because this is a lot longer conversation about truth. And join us on Sundays to learn about the truths that, from the Scriptures. And 9:30 a.m. Anyway, a couple plugs there. But our world is just so filled, jam-packed with lies. And even lies that sound good or what? They're still lies. Even when it sounds good or feels good for a time, they're still lies. We're going to wrap ourselves in these lies.
Let's record the adult classes. I can't participate in that.
I think we have the technology to record. Chris says,
Ray and I are going to do the membership class, and I'll highlight that doctrine part with her. On a Sunday evening coming up.
Okay.
That would
be great.
So not record on the Sunday mornings. Chris said no.
If you want. I can if you want, but yeah.
Oh, well, it's just, okay. I can't.
There's a little booklet that goes along with it. Chris can get you one. I know you're teaching Sunday school class. We'll talk. Let's talk if we want to record. There are truths in this world, though. And I'm glad you're interested in the Sunday class. To learn these truths about why we exist, who God is, who Jesus is, what they've done, what's to come, how we live in this world. And it all comes from the Scriptures. I want to watch this short video, but let's just watch this before we close. That's a clip from over in China where people are getting Bibles maybe for the first time in their lives. Do we treat our Bibles like that? Do we? Are we excited? Are we enthusiastic? Are we like, yes, this is what I've been waiting for my entire life. And now I have it. It's here. Are we enthused to read God's truth, His Scripture, to know His love? Do we have a deep appreciation about His unstoppable truth? It was everything to them. And how many times do we just toss it in the corner, let it collect dust, or, yeah, I'm too busy today? And I'm just trying to picture the mindset where this unstoppable truth in their life changes everything. The police might take it away, that the Chinese police might torture, kill, murder, if they found out they had God's scriptures. And so I just want to say, like, this is the truth and leads us to the way, the truth, and the life. Is your heart clinging to the truth? Is it seeking, searching after the truth? Do we even care? Or do we just follow our own truth, our own ways, our own will, our own lies in this culture? Let's be a little bit more like them. Like, wow, this book. It's not that we worship the book, but we get to know the God and Messiah who we worship through this book. And it changes everything. The truth of the scriptures that have been passed down for thousands of years, this changes everything. Do you wake up in the morning and go, yes! Yes! This is a truth for my life. Or do you go, no. I saw a video last week of a pastor kicking a Bible across stage for football, Super Bowl Sunday. Do you see that? As a visual illustration, I didn't get the whole context, but she kicked it and boom, it went across like a Bible. And I was like, whew, that's too far. I would not recommend that.
Unless she was trying to say...
That's how people treat it, yeah.
Well,
I don't know.
That football takes precedence over the
Bible. Maybe.
Maybe that was her.
Maybe.
I don't know.
Maybe.
I don't think I would do it.
I remember years ago, I took an old Bible and I ripped out some pages as an illustration to say this is, you know, what some people do. They rip it out and they crumple it up into... And the Bible was falling apart, and I don't even remember whose it was. I had found it somewhere, but I was using it as a visual aid to say, we don't want to just throw away the Bible. We've got to believe these truths. And Bill Newnham, he was ticked off. He was so upset that I ripped out pages of the Scripture and crumpled up the Bible, and maybe I shouldn't have done it. But he was like, this is holy, this is sacred, and I appreciate that. We had a little talk afterwards. If you remember, Bill. Yeah, I did. It's a good visual, but it's, you know, you don't want to mess too much with the Scriptures because they are holy and they are God's truth. You can write this down. We're going to close. Have courage to speak to... No, what's the next one? Is there one more? Yeah, what we believe determines how we behave. And we could get into this more another time. What we believe determines how we behave. It's not just thoughts, it's not just theology, it's not just words. What we believe, the truths that we hold dear, impact how we live and how we think and how we do life and how we treat other people. The truths that we believe impact us financially and relationally and emotionally and mentally and sexually and morally and in our work and with our spouse and in our kids and everything, especially spiritually, forever. It's not just, I believe this, you believe that, whatever. The truths that we believe, it changes the way we live. And so just remember that as you leave today. It changes the way we... Does the truth of God's Scriptures change the way you live? Because it should. And if not, we need to read it a little closer. We need to see, what are God's best ways of living for my life? What has He called me to as a loving Father? What has He asked me not to do? Like, don't murder people. Okay, I should probably not. That wouldn't be helpful. Right? This is God's unstoppable truth for our lives. And if we read it right, if we read it with not just this is what happened, but God, how are you calling me to apply this to my life right now today? That's what we got to be doing. Now, too much truth, well, let's say all truth with no grace leads to legalism and judgmentalism, but all grace and no truth leads to relativism and subjectivism and just do whatever you want with whoever you want, however you want, whatever makes you feel good or happy. And Jesus says, grace and truth, grace and truth. grace, and truth. I love you enough to say, hey, God's called us to live this way in this truth, and let me help you on that journey. Not, you shouldn't be down, you know, you're mamby-pamby, right? And whatever Nancy says to me, I don't know, when she preaches on the street corner, hellfire and brimstone. Grace and truth. Let's love one another enough, even in our congregation, to tell us the hard truths and to seek to combat the lies in the world. Because Paul's like, you foolish Galatians, you know. We've got to stay accountable with one another as we seek to follow the truth in a world that is just believing so many lies. And we want to be like Paul. He never stopped loving people. Go ahead, pass this around, take one. Pass this around, take one. God, Paul never stopped loving people, never stopped telling people about Jesus, no matter who they did or what they said to him. Pass around, take one. We want to be like that too. These are the truths of Scripture. No matter the flack that we're going to get, no matter what people are going to say or do to us, we want to be like Paul and say, look, if you destroy our life or everything around us, we still follow the truth. So what we have here is this kind of Berean, what do they call them? Anyway, I filled out a thing to be baptized before when I was a kid. My dad had these things like this, Berean reference notes. Now, you take this and you can look over this and bring this to class on Sundays, maybe for the class, why we believe what we believe. This is our doctrine, this is our teaching, and about a lot of different things that does change the way we think and change the way we live. So I just want to pass this out. I've had this in my office for years, but it's good to have. If you want more, I can get you more. But, excuse me, believing the truth, why we believe what we believe, it does change how we live. So we're going to sing our last song. And I hope and pray that you do hold the truths of the Scriptures dear, and that you don't say, yeah, whatever you want to believe, that's whatever, whatever is whatever, makes you happy, feel good. That's not how truth works. So the biggest question, you know, you can read all this and memorize every verse, but the biggest question, like the Pharisees, is what Jesus asked Simon Peter in Matthew 16, who do you say that I am? Even the Pharisees knew so much Scriptures, but they didn't know who the Scriptures were about. It's all about Jesus. And so, who do you say that Jesus is? That's the question everybody's got to ask themselves. That's a question that determines our life, how we live today, and how we'll live forever. Who do you say that Jesus is? I hope and pray that we are like Peter and say, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Died, who lived, died, rose forever. Who changes our lives and calls us to a mission to follow Him and do what He's called us to do. I love C.S. Lewis. You can believe Jesus is a liar, a lunatic, or Lord. But what you believe determines how you live. If we believe Jesus is Lord, we got to live like that. And the good news is that everybody can be saved. Today, if you haven't surrendered your life to the Lord, today, Hallie, today, right now, can't be the day of your salvation. You can know Jesus. It doesn't matter who you've been, what you've been, done, where you've been, where you've been or what you've done. You know, who you are, Jesus saves. And I think we hear that so much, we kind of can lose its impact. But just dwell on that this week, would you? Dwell on the Savior who has changed you and made you and I new today and forever, and that unstoppable truth will change your life. Let's stand and sing praises to the God who changes everything.
Sits on.
creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of light.
Father, you are truly holy, holy, holy. And we were truly separated from you because of our sin. But we praise your name. And we thank you, Jesus, for making a way back to God. It changes our life now and for forever. And makes all the difference in the world and in eternity. We couldn't have done it without you. We can't. And that is the truth. So we praise your name, Jesus, for bridging the gap between us and God, your Father. May we live our lives this week. May we go from here, this building, and be your church in this world filled with strength and courage and boldness and truth and love and grace and mercy, just like you've shown to us. Help us to love people right where they're at and speak into their life however they need to hear your truth. And I pray that we would internalize that truth ourselves. Look in the mirror first and say, how are you calling me to live and change? What mission are you calling me to do this week? Who do you want me to talk to and what words do you want me to say? Because you have changed our lives. And you want us to change the lives of those around us. Jesus, strengthen us as we do that. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.